contribute. Our chance to make change possible. Together, we are all working for a strong and progressive Europe. Only together we can. And together, we will. It's time to fight for your future. It's time to fight for a fair and social Europe. Let's do that together.
Hello, and welcome back, everybody, and welcome for those who were not here with us until now. We are now going to move towards a very interesting afternoon with many international guests. So this event of this afternoon is done together by the Young European Socialists, which is the European umbrella organization of socialist, social democratic, and labor youth organizations. And we are having this afternoon together with the S&D group in the European Parliament, bringing together the progressive members in the EU. We are also streamed today, so please welcome also those of you who are following us online. Feel free to join the debate over Twitter. And all of you, please feel free to post on social media and also join the discussion in other ways than just here on the stage. Today, we are looking forward of having a very interactive afternoon. So I encourage all of our participants to feel most confident to ask any question, take the floor, bring your ideas. Today, we have here more than 200 delegates from all over Europe representing different youth organizations, and this afternoon, therefore, is dedicated for debate. We are going to be joined by several amazing speakers, and we are going to start with a Finnish member of the European Parliament, and a former vice president of the Young European Socialists, right? And a great friend of mine, a great progressive Finnish politician, Mia-Petra Kumpula-Natri.
Thank you, Tuulia. How honored we are having Tuulia as Secretary General for the Young European Socialist. So this is will be down the winds from the 90s. Greetings from the 90s. I used to be the vice chair of ECOSI, the organization was called then. It's not that long ago, we had Madonna already in the 90s and so. So, but how great it was after years in ECOSI, getting friends all over European Union, 15 countries then, and then grow and see the family growing. Then I was personally 3 years working for the Prime Minister. Then I was 11 years in the National Parliament, and I was honored to come back to work full-time for the European politics, as I had so many good friends around Europe doing the same career. So I encourage all young people that once you have this family and knowledge, you know each other, it's very important to build on that one, on your future when you want work more and more concrete for the progressive Europe. Like saying that I've been more than 20 years in my home city council and working for the politics, I thought our duty is only to continue where the previous generation were working on for the Europe, for the social democracy. But now I see that we have to work even harder, as I see the clock ticking back somewhere. Is it the women's rights? I had a dream when I started that there's no glass ceilings anymore. Our president of the country became to be a female for the first time. I'm educated engineer myself, so I thought, no, I don't care about the digitalization because I can it. And I'm not like taking a side because I'm a woman. And now I do see that it's not self-evident anymore that of course women have right to their bodies. And I saw this ideological offer for what women should do to be respected mothers. And now I quote you, what our president Tarja Halonen said an hour ago in the seminar we organized together with the group chair Udo Bullmann and Tarja Halonen. And she was asked about the what is this right-wing populism model for women. And she said, yes, to honor them, so good mothers that they should stay home. And what is our answer? And she said, the President Halonen, we want that every woman has a right to stay home, but also right to go out to the labor market that they are not worse off, and to the labor market so that someone is taking care of the children. So this is what we want, equal chances for everyone and not to force people, women to stay home and not to talk about the right to abortion or right to do what you ever want. So for us, every citizen, every human being, being equal is a dream. And I thought it's only to continue, but we have to today work even harder. So we see the rise of populism in Europe, and what I see, what is good in there, and how it's good to have so many young people here. When everything is uncertain, everything is possible. And I see that the race and threat of the rising populism have one defender, and it is young people. If you look at the statistics, who's voting for the populistic movements mostly? It's not the poor only, but most of the time it seems to be middle-aged white men. And they are not majority. So if we trust that you are active, we don't have to be fear for the future. But if we start being passive and look what's happening in the society and passively following it, anything can happen. So I wish you very good stay in Finland, and as a now in the very small member state, we don't feel small anymore. As what we see now for the climate that I have been working on, for the digitalization I've been working on in the European Parliament, I don't feel small at all. I see me working in the institute that has the power to give rules for the 1/5 of the global gross national income. Do you remember that figure? When you talk about the European Union, you talk about more than 20% of the gross national income of the world. So if we say rules that we want the cars that are less polluting, by year 2030 we want cars that are nearly zero vehicles, emission vehicles of maximum 50 grams on 35% of the new cars has to be this kind. Do you think the car manufacturers overlook that they don't want to be the 1/5 of the global wealth? No, they will change the markets. But then also when I talk to young people, this I say that we did this great legislation just in December, that we will guide the markets, how the cars will be. Guess what is the young people in Finland, they ask me, why only 35%? And this is a very good question. Why don't we have more progressive view than what we want to do? And when we want to ban the plastics, that was voted on Thursday on Strasbourg, we want to ban the plastics nobody even needs. Plastic, small details in your life that you happily live without. What happens? We happen to solve the crisis even on the world. So please, use this power of European Union to steer the markets, to be Europeans that are proud to be in the European labor markets. Have you seen Europeans that wish to work in the conditions of the Asia? Or who want to flee to Europe to be in the working markets of the America? Or working conditions of Africa? We are proud of the European labor markets. But are we satisfied? No. But is there a threat that they will be changed for the worse? Yes. So again, I see that we have to use the tool. For me, the European Union is a dream, but also tool to guide the world and make it better. So when everything is unclear, not decided, and but we don't know how the future will be, then we know everything is possible. Please be active. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mia Petra. And also, thank you for all of the great cooperation that we have had with you over these past years. It's always great not only to have our alumni in the S&D group, but also to always be able to rely on your support on the work that we do in Brussels and all over Europe. Which leads me to our next guest addresses. We have a great pleasure to have here today with us, with all the young people from all over Europe, also the leader of the Socialists and Democrats group in the European Parliament, Udo Bullmann from Germany. I welcome you to stage.
Thanks, Julia. Friends, hello from my side. It's an honor for me to be here with you today. And together with my friends from the Socialists and Democrats group in Brussels, Mia Petra, together with Maria Joao, I have a message for you, an urgent one. Friends, we only have 10 years. 10 years to save this planet. If we wait, if 10 years are over after 2030, you know exactly, climate change will be irreversible. And you will see millions of people leaving their homes in areas where they cannot afford anymore to live, where no food, where no chances of their jobs are. And we will have much more than today, worldwide migration, to an extent nobody can imagine from today. So that have to be your 10 years, that have to be our 10 years, where we can be active and where we have to do something about it. And this is the very reason why we started a revolution in our program. We renovated our strategy. Socialists and Democrats in the European Parliament will never ever talk about the economy without talking about the environment. But we will also never ever talk about the environment without the social dimension, without social inclusion. This is our message also to Mr. Macron. Yes, you are right, Emmanuel Macron. The environment belongs on top of the agenda, but you cannot do it against the people. You have to do it with the people and by the people. This is our central message also to Paris, friends. Yes, Macron, you are right in defending democracy against the fascists in Paris, but it's not enough. It's not enough to improve the European institutions if people do not believe that you are in favor of a just transition, which is our program, the program of the socialists. And you cannot go that way successfully if you think you can cut the taxes of the rich and of the super rich and put all the burden of the transformation on the ordinary people. This is increasing our problems, not solving them. And this was the answer from the streets in France. And yes, Mr. Macron now is in a lifelong learning process, but we all have to do that in the European Union, as you know. We all have to be lifelong learners. Why shouldn't the liberals also be invited to that? So, here we go. We have decided to invite Greta Thunberg to the European Parliament because we think that these new social movements of young people taking to the streets, making clear, no, we don't have any patience anymore. We have to act, that this is real progress. We belong to the streets as well. This is our issue. We are in solidarity with this movement. But what happened in the European Parliament? When the Greens, when the left, when we invited this new movement, you know what the others said? The conservatives and the liberals? Oh no, the kids belong to school. They should go to school. Fridays for Future, what is that? No, the parliament has to be for the parliamentarians. So we really were ashamed. And we invited some 60 people, young people from all over Europe, to our party group meeting. This was an exciting event. We were listening. We were discussing. And the second speaker put us right in the middle of our debate. The second speaker, a young man, stood up and said the following. Are you social democrats? I join you in your fight. I understand what you said. It's right what you say about the environment. It's right what you say about the renewables. But look, I'm coming from a modest family. We are not rich back home. Our home, my family home, should be warm in winter as well. Yes, I would like to have this renewable energy, but can we afford it? My brothers, my sisters, we would like to have quality food like you would like to have it. But can we pay for it? This organic food is still more expensive than all the others. Do you care for us? Have you an idea what segregation is? Standing always in front of the doors where the other can buy and purchase whatever they would like to do? Have you an idea how we could belong to your movement of transformation? Here we go, my friends, here we go. This is the center of our debate. And believe me, we are the only ones, the socialists and democrats, are the only one in the European Parliament, and our family is the only family European-wide to defend the idea that we only can save the planet by a radical social change. It's not only about the greening of the neoliberal model. It's about the social revolution to put us on new footing in the environment and in the social inclusion policy. Please help us getting forward with this political program. This is what the fight is about. And we are not certain that the others have understood. We welcome the Greens if they support us on that, but they have to learn their story as well. It's not about the greening of the bourgeois neighborhood. It's about everybody. And the left should understand that it's not about top-down politics, but about bottom-up. We are about the people and not about the ideologies. And those conservatives who have understood what it is about are always invited to join us. But believe us, believe the friends in the party group in Brussels, we will be the one to lead us after the election on this program. We will not go for the wrong deals. This time, it's not about posts, it's about people. This time, it's about our program, which we put on the table. It's about sustainable equality. It's about everybody, not the happy few. It's about the politics for the many, not the few. This is what we say. This is the socialist message. And here I would invite you warmly to come together and to strengthen our campaign. We need you. You know that. And we have many enemies. I do not know whether you have seen this most ugly video of the true Finns that was launched during the last days. Mia Petra showed me today. This is fascist ideology. This is the spread of hatred. This is what the right wing is doing here in Finland and everywhere else in Europe. Yes, we have enemies from the outside. That is Putin on the one side. They don't like our civic freedoms. That is Mr. I forgot his name, in the White House on the other side, who does not know our social labor rights. And he does not accept that the whole world is not his personal business model. And there are many, many forces, Steve Bannon and others, who would like to undermine us. Friends, reminds me on something. We have big challenges. Digitalization, climate change, migration, uncertainties, new cleavages here and there. But this is the archaic divide of this world. When the right gets under pressure, what are they doing? When the right wing gets under pressure, they are looking around in their communities and they try to identify who is looking different. Who is the one with the different belief, with the different heritage, with the different roots? And this one is to become the scapegoat. This one is to become the guilty. And when we can expel this person or this group or this social entity, then we are going back to all the good of the past. This is the ideology of the Nazis. This is the ideologies of those at the very end who kill people. When the left people feel the threat, when the left people, this is our family, when we see people are stumbling, no, they are falling, they are on their knees, then we behave differently. Then we ask ourselves the question, could it be me? Yes, it could be me also. Could it be perhaps my brother or my sister? Yes, could be my brother or my sister. Perhaps it's my brother and my sister. And we are family with those people who suffer. And we are together and we stand together with those who suffer. And we know the promise of the left, the history of the left. If we stay together, if we join our energy, then we can leave the past behind us, the backward-looking past. We can join our forces and tomorrow is going to be a better land. Tomorrow is going to be a better time than today. This is the heritage of the left. And this is right the opposite than the belief of hatred, the belief of hate, and the belief of expellation. This is the politics of hope. And we invite you, we the socialist family have to stand together for this politics of hope. And then this next 5 years, the next mandate, will be a chance to change the page to the better. Again and again, we promise to you, a promise of my leadership, a promise of my friends in the European Parliament, we will not go for any dirty deals. We will not go for pre-compromising on posts. We will go for the politics for our people. And this is where we need all of you, each and everybody of the young socialists. Please help us. I'm looking forward to a strong campaign, looking forward to our collaboration. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Udo. Thank you so much for joining us and for your speech. It is very important for the young social democrats all over Europe not only to discuss with one another in the European level, not only to be in a very good dialogue with our political mother party and the group in the European level, but also to be in a dialogue with the national parties. We all know that the progressive movement in Europe has faced many challenges, but there are also some movements, such as the one that we have here in Finland, that have managed to also to turn their direction of the political support and of their ideas. And To start this dialogue, I would like to introduce our next guest speaker, the Secretary General of the Social Democratic Party here in Finland, Anton Rönnholm.
Thank you so much, Tuulia. Dear friends, comrades, it's glad to be here addressing you. And I have to say that the organization was called something else when I was active in it. But nevertheless, regardless of the name, which I think nowadays is very good, it's glad to have you here in Helsinki. You're very welcome all. I'm very glad that you're having your meeting here. And thank you also, Mia, Petra, and Udo, for the great addresses you made earlier. I have with me here the short book of 115 pages, which I will read out loud to you in a moment. No, this is our election manifesto. It's not the small red book, as in a country known fairly well from early decades. It's a middle-sized book, but it's called the Future Line, our goals for the next mandate and up to 2030. And the story here, to give you an idea of the national context that we are social democrats in this country, I'd like to remind you of a book which probably some of you have read. It's called Great Expectations by Dickens. It's from a time in the 19th century, which unfortunately some of our opponents want to bring us back to. Time of poverty, of time of social exclusion, and so on. But it has also a message which has to do with the situation here. And the Finns are quite moderate in their expectations. And this is something that Udo was addressing. It's about the belief in the future, the hope for the future. And we believe that all elections are based on a strong emotion, and it's either fear or hope. And we wanted to go for the hope. But in order to create hope, in a country where people are, let's say, very pragmatic and not always so bright on their outlook for the future, we needed to make a very, very thorough work on what is the hope, what will be the hope based on. And this is what we're talking about when I talk about the manifesto. We had 450 people working on this text or these texts for 2 years. It required a lot of work. It's hard labor, not manual, but requires a lot of sitting, as you all know, active in a political organization. And we managed to do this. And the idea behind the book is the UN Development Goals. We look at sustainability from three different angles. Not only the economic one, whether we can afford it, which is the prevailing debate in this country from an election to another, but also from the ecological point of view, as we all know, is very important, and from the social one. What does it make sense that we have the money if it does not benefit the people? And these were the three dimensions that we worked on, and we created the manifesto. And I have to say, we've been challenged quite a lot during this campaign, and we have still a couple of weeks to go. But all the topics and all the discussions have been on, in a way, on our terms, because all the issues arise from the work that we've done together as social democrats. So we basically brought our work back to the 1960s, the great era of building the Nordic welfare societies, and we're trying to do it again by the help of this. And our work is based on, as said, three dimensions. It's about work and growth. We want to guarantee all the Finnish youth a secondary degree free of charge. We know that if you don't have a secondary degree, you will not fare well in the job market in the future. But it's not only about the youth, it's also about the working people in this country. We need a lifelong learning, a continuous learning scheme that means possibilities for everyone in this country, regardless of what you're doing, whether it be white collar or blue, a possibility to learn new skills, not on the level of a degree, but nevertheless in a micro college or something like that. We're talking about educating 50% of the youth in this country with a higher degree. That I think is essential for a small country like we. We don't have a lot of people. We need all the skills. And the last but not the least, we need the taxes to finance this. We need to shift the balance of taxing people for their income into taxing the massive capital gains that that the companies and certain individuals have. And the second topic that we talk about, obviously, is the ecologically sustainable society. We made a commitment that we will make Finland CO2 neutral by 2035. That means transport, that means the urban planning, that means agriculture. It's a massive work, but we're going to do it, and we also will take the other parties along with that, whether we are in the government, but we need to do it together. And we also we will introduce a VAT on just sustainable consumption, meaning that the smart things, that we are directed as consumers to buy things that are less CO2 producing, that are more environmentally friendly. And last but not the least, we want to do a just transition in this country. We've seen what's happened on the streets of Paris with the Gilets Jaunes, and we don't want to see this here. The only way to go about with this transition is to do it in a just way. And the last is the social sustainability. We need to take care of everyone in a society. And this in practice means that we want to guarantee full-time childhood education free of charge to all the children in this country. That means that if you are growing up in this country, you, regardless of the income of your parents, are entitled to have free of charge early childhood education that then builds the basis for you to go to school, to learn new things, and to build your life. And we have research on this, and this is very crucial, and that's why we are demanding on this. We want to create a flexible school day, so it's going to be easier for the families to work to spend more time with the kids in a way that does not require a lot of work and hassle when it comes to hobbies. And then we have a big scheme on childhood poverty. We will reissue the same student aids that the grants that we had prior to this right-wing government when they cut the grants. We will bring them on the same level for students. And then, of course, there are a couple of big reforms that we need to do. One is on family leave. It has to be, we have to give the right for all the parents to spend time with their kids, especially the fathers, and also encourage the women to take more actively part in the workforce so we get a fairer division of work and pay in the society. So on these three accounts, we have a big manifesto. And of course, we are competing of the people's time during the election time. They have a lot to do. They have their kids, they have their work, they have their hobbies, their parents, and so on. But we need to bring them this message of that the hope that we can provide is justified. It can be done, and it will be done, and we can actually finance it just by being fair. But what I wanted to say with this long rant about our program is that even though the current political climate in this country and most of the countries in Europe seems to be very much concentrated on social media, on Twitter, being very active, being witty, being sometimes even, you know, nasty towards your opponents, politics is always based on your programs, your ideas, and your ability to communicate them, not to bash your counterparts. And this, I think, is the one thing that we've learned here. And of course, Finland wants to be bigger. Last but not least, Finland wants to be bigger on the European and on the global scale as well. We need to take more responsibility, whether it to be environment or the developing the European Union. And this is a call that I make to you all, is that you've seen what's happened in the last decades. I would call it a global conspiracy of neoliberalism that's been going on for the last 40 years. If we want to take back our countries, if we want to take back this continent, and on the global level, the whole world, to bring more hope, justified hope to the people. We need to do it in a very planned, carefully skilled way, and we need to be trained for that. And this training will happen in universities and schools. It will not happen in the party headquarters or sitting in meetings. So we need to be prepared for this, and we need to be well planned to do it. But we can do it because we are the socialists, and we can bring about hope, and I think we will do it in this country, and I'm really sure that you will all do it in your countries. And I know also that Maria is producing a lot of good research on this that we can base it on, and then we have our Spitzenkandidat to represent us on the European level. We are very proud of you, having you all here as well. Thank you very much. Do a good work, learn, and then take control of your parties and the whole world. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Anton, for your most inspiring speech. I think there is a lot to learn from these words, and I'm very much looking forward for our Young European Socialist Congress Day tomorrow, because then we have a real chance to develop our own ideas and continue our own debates based on all of these inspiring speeches that we have had so far. But now, my dear friends and comrades, we are moving towards the next guest address, because we have just had the pleasure of having Frans Timmermans, the first Vice President of the European Commission and the Spitzenkandidat of the Party of European Socialists, with us. And it is so great to have you here, Frans. So I know you've been running around, you must be very busy, but I can tell you we couldn't be more honored to have you here with us today. So please, if you are ready, we welcome you to the stage.
Thank you very much. Have you been having a great day so far? Yes. Have you been having a great day so far? Yes. Anybody alive out there? Anybody ready to go campaign? Yeah. Anybody ready to go change Europe? Yeah. Isn't it time? Yeah. It's time. I'll tell you why. There's a huge ideological battle going on in the world, and we're part of this. It's a battle between those who believe you can create safety, security, prosperity by building walls. Not just physical walls, but also walls into the hearts of people, between people. It's a world vision that says we need to take back control by eliminating everything that's different, because that's a threat. It's a world vision that says the past was better, let's go there again. And then they present a vision of the past, which has nothing to do with the past, to promise something that they can't deliver. And the only thing they will deliver is disappointment, anger, hatred. And then they will go and look to blame a scapegoat. The Jews, the Muslims, young people, women, minorities. Okay, I mentioned that vision. That is not our vision. But this vision will dominate if we do not put our vision first and foremost in front. You can only defeat a negative vision by having a positive vision, not by attacking the negative vision. What I'm saying this, if you open a cafe here in Helsinki and you want to get people to come to your cafe, it will not help by saying the neighbor's cafe is bad. It will only help by saying, hey, here you can have a good time, here we have quality stuff, here we bring people together. If there's one thing we need to do now, is bring people together. If there's one thing I'm asking of you now, is to bring people together. wherever I go in Europe now, and it's a great journey. It's a great journey. I'm having such a great journey. Yes, it's tiring, and yes, sometimes it's frustrating. But I'm learning so much every day. And wherever I go, I meet young people. Wherever I go, they say to me, we're worried. We're not happy. We want things to change. Yes, we're Europeans, but we want a different Europe. We want a Europe that understands that we need to act now on climate change, that we need to act now on a sustainable economy, that we need to act now to attack the divisions in society, that we need to make sure that there's a minimum wage everywhere in every member state, that we need to make sure that if we have a job, these jobs are decently paid with decent conditions. And everywhere I go, young people say to me, we can't afford an apartment. We can't afford housing. Do something about that. And my reaction is, yes, we will. We will make sure Europe does something about that. We will weaponize Europe to do something against climate change. We will weaponize Europe to do something for sustainability. We will weaponize Europe to create better social conditions. We will weaponize Europe to make sure that there's housing for people who don't have a lot of money. I am inspired on a daily basis by people of your generation. Greta Thunberg is somebody that has inspired millions of young Europeans. The election in May is the first election of Europe where people who were born this millennium can go and vote. Just imagine that. This millennium. Are they going to go and vote? When I address people, I say we need to do something about sustainability. I had it 2 weeks ago in the Netherlands. Young people coming up to me said, yeah, we like your story, but are you actually doing the right thing? Are you doing what you're saying? Are you practicing what you're preaching? Are you really sustainable yourself? Should I follow you? And my reaction is this. What I ask of myself and my family and my loved ones is to do the best we can. Is that perfect? No, it's not. Do we make mistakes? Yes, we do. But we try. And that's all that I'm asking of other people, to try and do the right thing on the right issues. You know, we just decided to have a plastic strategy in Europe, which is really leading in the world. Just the European Parliament voted on it last week, across the board. I think there were only 35 votes against out of 751 members of the European Parliament. Unthinkable 3 years ago, it's reality now. We can do these things step by step. But more importantly is this. I'm not perfect. I try. Sometimes I succeed. Sometimes I don't. But that should not be the reason why you do something, yes or no. You should just ask yourself, is this the right thing to do? And if you believe it's the right thing to do, you do it. You don't wait for me, you don't wait for others. You do it. And if you lead on this, I promise I will follow and I will bring everyone with me who wants to follow me. But lead. Lead. Have the audacity to lead. That's what I tell your generation. You are the most idealistic, the healthiest, the strongest, the best educated, the most European generation in European history. Use that. Use that. Use that at a time when the world needs your idealism to make sure we don't make mistakes that will haunt many generations to come. Use that to set Europe on a path of sustainability, of social justice. Use that to create an international environment of cooperation and not of confrontation. Use that to show to those who are tempted by the nationalists and the extremists that there is an alternative that doesn't need hatred, that doesn't need confrontation, that embraces cooperation, that likes difference and diversity, that sees borders as something that we need to remove and not as something that we need to foster, that sees Europe as an opportunity and not as a threat. I'm sure that if you find the right words, the right methods, I'm sure that if you understand that you can take over political parties, create your own political parties, create your own movements, I'm sure if you do that, you can convince the majority of Europeans to go into that direction. It's time we acted on climate change. It's time we created more social justice. It's time we forced big corporations to finally start paying taxes where they make profits. It's time we empowered the trade unions again to negotiate decent contracts for people who do decent jobs. In other words, it's time we brought Europe back into the hearts and minds of people. Thank you very, very much. Thanks. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Franz, very much for your most inspiring words. Now we are going to move forward in our discussion. As said before, dialogue is the most important thing that we can have in the European political family. And what would be a dialogue without a proper discussion with our most important partners? I would like to now welcome to the stage three people who represent the partner organizations of the Young European Socialists and of the SND. Camila Garcias from Rainbow Rose. Then I have Anna Pirkshalava, UC Secretary General. And last, but totally not the least, Vice President of the SND Group at the European Parliament, President of the Foundation for European Progressive Studies, Maria João Rodrigues. Welcome. Wow, we have an all-female panel. Very nice. Very good, my friends. So, in this part of this afternoon, we're also going to have a little bit more room for debate. So please, my dear audience and my dear friends, be prepared to ask questions and also take part into this discussion. But first, I would like to give the floor for our amazing female panel here to hear short addresses from you. What do you want to say for us today? Please, Camila from Rainbow Rose, you can start. And then we move this way.
Hello. Okay. Sorry. Hi, my name is Camilla. I used to be in Young European Socialists Bureau. I'm from Austria, and it's my great pleasure to be here invited. Now, being the youngest on the podium, but not representing the youth, however. I'm the president of Rainbow Rose, the socialist LGBTIQ organization of Europe. That said, that I liked a lot that we're gonna speak about youth enrollment and youth empowerment. Why do I say that, being a representative of LGBTI people? Just recently, the OECD studies showed that more young people are proud of who they are and are proud enough to say, I am LGBTI, I'm a lesbian, I'm gay, I'm bisexual, I'm transgender. They do that because the social situation in their countries have improved a lot in the last years. And the study showed that the improvement came and had a lot to do with the legal improvements and anti-discrimination laws. And here we come to politics. If the politicians in the countries, if the politicians in the European Union don't fight for protective legislation, if we say that the social change will come without political action, without legislation, then it even might be true, it even might come, but it would take much, much longer. A time that we as young people don't have. We want to be who we are, we want to love who we want, whoever we want to love, and we want to be proud of who we are. That's why we want to be politically active, we want to be politically involved, and that's why it's so great that a lot of LGBTI young people are involved in Fridays for Future. Because it's our future. And I'm very thankful for Udo and for Franz who explicitly spoke about this topic. But it is necessary to do the economic analysis about this. Who is doing over 70% of the pollution? It's the companies. And it's important to fight for individual possibilities to fight against climate change. But individual behavior cannot change and reverse the pollution and the destruction of the earth. It is important to take this analysis and to take into responsibility all those companies. And if we do so, if we follow the young leaders, if we follow the young generation, if we follow all of you in your youth organizations, in your countries, that means to give you space, that means to give you a podium, that means to give you spaces on our election lists. And I'm a very, very strong supporter of representation of young people, a representation of migrants, and representation of LGBTI. So this is also a call for you, and I support that, Franz. Get involved and demand of your parties to give you a space. And this is a call to our parties. We need to give LGBTI people, young people, and migrants places to speak up, spots on our lists. Because then young people and those fighting for a better world will find representation within our parties and will get involved. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Camila. I can say I couldn't agree more with you. Thank you so much for your inspiring words. Now we move forward to the International Union of the Socialist Youth, which is our global umbrella organization. Imagine that. The biggest party political youth organization in the whole world. Anna, please.
Thank you, Tulia. I have been told that it's going to be a TED Talk format, but I want to start it with an Oscar speech, because I want to start it with a thank yous, first of all. I would like to thank SDY and Song Finland for amazing organizational work they have done, and also to you and Joao and all the leadership of YES for organizing all this event, and especially to you, Tulia, as an outgoing Secretary General. As a Secretary General colleague, I know that it's not the easiest job to do, but it's really worth it, and you have done amazing work, and thank you for all the cooperation we have done together between UC and YES. And indeed, international cooperation is very important for us, so thank you. As Tulia mentioned, I'm here representing around 140 organizations from all around the world. And now, right now, all our eyes and attentions are directed towards Europe, but not only because of the elections coming up at the end of May, even though because of this as well. But at the same time, we are paying attention to you. What are the answers the left are providing towards the crisis we are having nowadays? Because indeed, we are in the crisis, but in a crisis of ideas and big ideals. We as a left, during history, and we need to acknowledge and be proud of it. We were in an avant-garde of egalitarian movements. We were always the one leading the movements, fighting for more inclusive, more feminist, more just societies. Therefore, it is important that we emphasize it, and we don't put ourselves only in the defense position and only responding the topics that are put on the agenda by right-wing extreme movements, but we need to create alternatives, because yes, we are the ones who were saying, yes, there is an alternative. This was always our message, and this also needs to be our message too. And Mr. Bullman and Mr. Timmermans are very, very much right when they are speaking about the future of Europe, because yes, indeed, we need the ideas and visions about the future, how we are going to go on in the future. But at the same time, we need a discourse where there is also a space for EU enlargement and neighborhood policies, because we know that we have European countries from Balkans, from South Caucasus, Eastern Europe, that really indeed are waiting for our policies to lead and to show solidarity with them. We also need the agenda where there is also space for our cooperations from Americas, from Asia Pacific, from Africa, from MENA region, because we, more than no one, we social democrats know that injustice anywhere can really be a threat to justice now and here where we are. Therefore, I think that more international solidarity and more emphasis on the global democracy should be our message as well. Thank you.
Wow, thank you so much. It was a really, really inspiring speech for me at least. And thank you so much for your kind words. And now we move forward for the president of the Foundation for European Progressive Studies. So FEPS, the foundation, is a very close partner of the Young European Socialists and of our political family in Europe. And we have done some many great projects together, such as a millennial study, which we have also used in the work of the Young European Socialists. So you have always been a great supporter of ours. So please, Maria João, take the floor.
Well, many thanks, Tulia, and hello, everybody. Look, I think this is a great topic we have above us, empowering youth. And let's have a good discussion about this. So I will say something now, but I know that the TED Talks are about questions and answers, so let's open the debate about this afterwards. Let me tell you, first of all, my own experience. Because I start as a young leader, as you are, and then I decided to make the tour of European institutions and the Council, Commission, and European Parliament. And let me tell you my conclusion, is that, yes, we miss a lot of young people in these European institutions, and we also miss more women. So we need to have a major rebalancing of the way power takes place in the European Union if you want really to meet the kind of challenges behind of us and in front of us. Now, let me also tell you my conclusion from my experience, but then I'd like to listen from you, is the first question we need to ask if we want to empower young people is what for? We need to have a strong sense of purpose. Why we need more young people in the places where decisions are about to be taken. What for? And I really think, and France was so clear about that, Udo, Mia Petra, we are really confronted with much bigger challenge ever. Because if we think climate change, and nobody can deny now the importance of this, this is absolute imperative from now on to address climate change. Then we know that we are going to a new phase of the digital revolution where we need to invent a European way to make the best of the European revolution. This means to have better protection of our private life, our personal choices. We need to make sure that digital tools are there to empower us, democracy, but not to undermine democracy. We need to make sure that digital solutions are there to improve our lives. And we need to make sure that these will be translated in more and better jobs with better conditions. So yes, next generation should be in charge of driving this digital revolution. And then we know that in order to cope with this, we need more resources. And more resources, yes, they are there, provided we have fair taxation. That's why fair taxation would be such an important priority for the next phase. So these are some of the ideas we need to push for. But now let me ask the second question. is the how. How can we empower young people? Because this is something you are asking all the time. And yes, you are right when we call for more participation of young people in the list for the next European Parliament, in the way we organize power at all levels, local, national, European, international. So we need really to invent representative democracy, but we also need to invent participatory democracy. And I believe that we have in our hands new ways to do this exactly because of digital tools. Right now, we are testing new ways of involving young people to come up with new solutions by using these digital tools. So you need to be really very ambitious about this. And let me tell you my last question, which is also about the where and the when. Because there is a little secret of politics is, of course, we need to be in the right place in the right moment each time. And I believe that now Helsinki is a very important place to be, because we have the Congress to prepare the new phase of YES with João in the leadership, and all the presidium. We have Helsinki as a critical place to bring social democrats to power in Nordic countries. And we have Helsinki taking the lead of the European Union with social democrats at the helmet for the next month's critical period. So that's why it's so important that all the families together today in Helsinki. That's it.
Thank you very much. And I can also say on my behalf, as I am from Helsinki, that I couldn't be happier to have all of you here today. Now we have an opportunity to take some questions. If you are interested in sharing your thoughts, please don't be shy and raise your hand. Do we have a question for the panelists? Two over here. We have the microphone coming, so we start with Vera and then we take Carmelo. And please say your name, tell us where you come from. And also, if you can ask a general question or address one of our great panelists in person. Thank you.
Thank you. So my name is Vera. I come from SDY Finland. And the topic of this discussion is empowering youth. And you talked about empowering youth. How can that be done? Well, in my opinion, that has already happened. We have climate strikes all over Europe. Youth are taking action, and they are taking the initiative, and they demand that we do our job in resolving climate crisis. So the question is that now that we are heading towards better times, where social democrats are taking the leadership of the climate change and tackling that, how can we ensure that we actually do what we are promising and we deliver, so that we won't disempower these youth that are actually now taking action and believing that we can actually change the world? So this is a general question for all of you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Vera. And if it's okay, maybe we can have a round of answer for this one and then have Carmelo's question afterwards. Is that okay? We can start with Maria João, please.
Look, many thanks for this great question, because you are coming with a brilliant example. Is that all of a sudden, young people, they show they are strong calling for climate action now. We can no longer wait. This is so clear. Last week was so clear about this all over the world. And we know that young people, they are really mobilized by causes. We know this. And this is the best example we now have. Now, how can we make sure that this big movement will not be disappointed in the end? We, Social Democrats, we do have a responsibility about this, because we need to listen to this large, young social movement coming, and we need to translate these then in real decisions. And we, Social Democrats, we are a powerful political family. We have connections everywhere. And then we have a legitimate power at local, national, European level, and international, everywhere. Let me recall you that this year, the General Assembly of the United Nations is about climate change. And we have Guterres there. This is one example. Let us recall that at European level, we have several governments committed with this, and we have a powerful SED group, and Udo Rust recall this. We can change European law. We voted European law for climate change a few days ago. And this is so powerful to feel the European Parliament voting in the right direction. This was possible because we have a powerful group there. And we need to have, again, a powerful group there. And to have a large coalition of progressive forces pushing in the same direction. So my answer for you is, where is the secret of political success? Is to make the best of this strong social movement, bottom-up, powerful, and then translate this into real decisions in the institutions of representative democracy. We need to work with the two legs.
I will pretty much repeat the same. Our movements are coming bottom up, and indeed it's very important that young people are taking very concrete and strong actions towards certain issues, and how to ensure that they are delivered and implemented. Exactly, that's why we also need young people to be in decision-making processes, in order to make sure that everything we are fighting for are also implemented, and it doesn't stay on the level of only manifestations and grassroots as well. Yeah.
I think one of the first steps is to acknowledge the problem and to pin it on our agenda and to have it as one of our four most important issues. So that's definitely one thing. We don't leave this topic to the Greens anymore. It's a really social issue, and it affects everyone, and we have to consider that socioeconomic poorer groups of society are more affected of these, because they can't buy organic food and they can't rely on other resources. So taking this on our agenda is definitely one of the first steps. I do hope that that helps to keep the movement running, because I think that it needs both. It needs the mobilization on the streets, it needs the mobilization of young people, and it needs politicians that actually do what they promise. But then you have to know that you cannot promise something that you cannot do. But the European election is a decision between those who represent and fight for great companies and the rich, and those who fight for the people, and who fight for those working class people and young people and minority people that want to see a real change. And the socialists, that is the political party group that represents those people. And we need to make that clear. The decision between EPP or ALDE and our party is a we fight for the people. We are not gonna bend before the companies, never ever. And that is a huge decision that is to be taken during these elections. So we need to make that clear, and then, well, still go to the streets, go to the demonstrations, be there, and show that the socialists are unapologetic with this and will fight for a real change.
Thank you very much. We had this next question, please.
Yeah, dear comrades, as we see on Europe, there's a lot of young people that are getting active. while our party and our socialist structure are sticking to what I would qualify as crumbling institution and practice. And my question, do you think there is a necessity to radically change our institution and the people that embody them by occupying mandate for a very long time? And if you answer yes to that question, my following question would be, what are the first steps to get this radical change according to you?
Thank you very much. Shall we start with Anna this time, and then we can go to Maria Joao and continue with Camille?
If I understood your question correctly, it's how to ensure that there is a change of leadership or power, right? Yeah, it's about internal party democracies, and that's why we need to strengthen and have the very clear rules and in the statutes how to ensure that there is constant change and the party structures are transparent and democratic, and that's all about internal democracies of the parties or the organizations and movements.
Well, in fact, the problem here is how are our political parties working? And I think that if we want political parties of the 21st century, they need to be completely reconsidered on the way they operate. First of all, something about membership. Who can be member of the parties? And to answer this, you need to ask, what is a party for? And a party is for organizing political democratic representation, but the party is also to listen to people, to involve people wherever they are, changing reality, fighting for a better world. And the parties need to be connected with all these movements. That's why in the end, you need to change the criteria to address membership of the parties. If you open the parties to new kind of members, then you have a new basis to decide. Because then parties are there really to change reality, not only to change the composition of the democratic institutions. This is a big difference. As you have a party with new kind of members, then the balance of power in parties change. And you can identify new kind of leaderships. And again, the last point is, who should be leading? And I think that we should be in favor of leading teams, really representing society. And society is composed by men and women at all ages and all preferences. So the leading teams should reflect this. So this means that we have some long way to go. This is my comment.
I absolutely agree. We need radical change, we need radical democratization of our parties and our movement, and thus also the institutions of the European Union, which only we can then provide. I'll give you an example. In Vienna, 2 years ago, I think, we had to elect a new party leader. And normally, like it has been done in more than 100 years of history in SPÖ, well, you have one candidate. That's not a real democratic battle. You have one candidate and you elect him, or, well, him, yeah, because it's only been men so far. But 2 years ago, we had two candidates. And that brought a lot of people to get involved and brought a lot of people to get active in discussions, to show clearly their ideological and their political positions. And there were two candidates, and we had elections. We had true democratic elections between two candidates to lead the party in Vienna. And independent of who won, the party, against all expectations, didn't implode. The people didn't leave the Congress, but we had elections. A new party leader was elected, and he has become the new mayor of Vienna. And I tried to tell this a lot in my party organization in my district, that democracy doesn't hurt us. Democracy brings more people to get involved in every structure. And it has been shown in various parties. We don't need to be afraid of that. We need to actively promote it. And then I think that this movement can once again thrive.
Thank you so much. We have a little bit of time if there is something, some other question raising from the audience. Oh, now we have three. So let's take all of them. So we can start with Pedro and Love and Sara. Could somebody be so kind and bring the microphone? Here, this guy. So if it's okay, we will hear all of your questions, all of the three questions now, and then we will have a round of answers.
Okay, hello everybody. I have a question for Camilla. My question is, my impression is that the importance for the fight for LGBTQI plus rights isn't or hasn't arrived in every organization of our family. So I would like to know, what do you think, how can YES and Rainbow Rose cooperate more? How can we support you, or how can we support each other to deal with that obstacle?
Thank you very much. And then we had Löwe.
Hello, I am from the Swedish Social Democratic Student Union. And in Sweden, we usually say that the Social Democrats have to be both the shield protecting the working class, but also the spear pointing to the new society. How can we at the same time inspire those two feelings in youth around Europe? Thank you very much.
Thank you. And Sara.
Thank you. My name is Sara and I come from SDU Finland. Thank you for the inspiring panel so far, by the way. So my question is actually about the future of the European Union. For many young people, I think that they can only remember EU politics in the context of one crisis or another. The financial crisis, migration crisis, the mess we call Brexit. And I was wondering, what do you think? How can we ensure that young people can have faith in the European Union, given this history of a crisis or another for at least the last 10 years? Do we need evolution or revolution of the European Union? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now we go to an answer round. So maybe we can start with Camilla.
Yeah, maybe I'll start with Pedro's question. Yeah, the youth, your youth organizations can absolutely support the LGBTI movement in your countries. If you don't have an LGBTI organization, you can organize and cooperate with NGOs. You can always contact Rainbow Rose. We're very happy to also go local and help there. But what is most important that has really helped show a clear sign is that our top politicians like Frans Timmermans are very clear in this position that human rights must be equal to everyone. And France has always been an LGBTI ally, and this is a clear sign also to those parties within our family who are not yet so sure how to stand with this. And France has been very, very clear on that, as has the PES leadership. We're very grateful for that, and this cooperation also shows that the path is clear for us, and the legislation that has been passed in the last years in the European Union also shows that we are moving for more rights and not for less rights. On the other hand, just, you know, get organized. If you can get organized as an ally also, as motivate your LGBTIQ plus friends to get involved. You can all become members of Rainbow Rose. So there are many ways, but I think that one of the most important things is that as a political family, we are very clear on this, and that we won't tolerate any discrimination against anybody in Europe and the world. The other questions, I will try to maybe combine them a bit, because the questions were on how can we shield young people from unemployment as it has been after the financial crisis, but at the other hand, how can we point towards a future that we fight for? I think that I will have to be a bit autocritical at this point, because I think that in the last years, in maybe the last two decades, as socialists and social democrats, we have lost our capacity to speak about the utopia we fight for. I give you an example. In Austria, socialist politicians for many years said that our goal is full employment. We haven't been talking about full employment in the last 10 years in Austria. And this is something that we have to relearn again. We have to have clear path and clear goals, as it is to have full employment with less working hours and same salaries, for example. Point towards an ideological goal with a social democratic society where these rights can be achieved. And we also have to make clear that we really believe that we can work on that. It doesn't make any sense to say, yes, we believe in an equal society and in a socialist utopia, if we don't really have the tools and the way to reach it. We have to know, if we want to have full employment, what are the next steps? It's using digitalization, it's reducing working hours, and it's implementing minimum standards for employment, as is, for example, a European minimum wage. So we have to be very clear in communicating our utopia, and it is a utopia where everyone can be and thrive as an individual. And on the other hand, be very clear what tools we have against all the attacks that we have from right-wing parties and right-wing movements, but also of companies that don't want to pay their taxes and of companies who pollute our earth. So we know the tools. We just have to put the two things together, the tools and the utopia we want to reach. I think that should be our way.
We hear a lot from our parties, traditional parties, that it's young people are being having apathy, they are not interested in joining traditional political parties. And I think the reason of it is also maybe the young people don't see themselves in the agenda of the parties. We just don't see the solutions and the policies that concerns us. I know that we as a socialist and social democratic movements, we started all our struggle based on the workers and their rights, but economy changes and changed and changes all the time. Now we are having a different form of economy, and young people are working in very precarious conditions in the companies like Uber or this Airbnb, new forms of economy. So we really need to listen to and observe to the ongoing changes happening in society and where young people are affected the most, and then creating the answers and the policies about it. That's a way of the communicating with each other.
Well, many thanks for these great questions. Let me ask you like that. Yes, social democrats, socialists, sometimes they are perceived as an old-fashioned party. The party just taking care of the traditional working class. And people can feel that there is no real mission when it comes to young people. So let me address exactly this issue. I believe that social democrats and socialists, they need to fight social inequalities, the old ones and the new ones. This is their really central mission. So this means that when it comes to traditional working class, we need to come up with new solutions, example, industrial policy coupled with energy transition and social support. This is necessary. But we also need to address the new social inequalities. And we need to see what is happening in the digital economy. When you see online platforms providing jobs of millions of people now, most of them young people, we need to update our welfare system to deal with this. And let me tell you what we're doing right now. Right now, we have launched something called European Social Pillar, exactly with this purpose. Because we're saying, whatever the job you have, whatever the sector, whatever the region, you need to count on two very important things. One is a decent labor contract, if this is a digital job, and the second is full coverage by social protection. Social protection, when dealing with unemployment, disease, whatever, should be there. And we approve this in this European Parliament. We translate this into law. We have very recent laws in this direction. But now we need to make sure this will be implemented. That's why it's so important to fight for strong representation in the next European Parliament. Which brings us to the second question. What do you want from the European Union? Do you really need the European Union? Well, let me tell you, yes, I think that Social Democrats, they need European Union to implement their agenda. We have reached a point where it's no longer possible to implement our agenda just at national level. If we don't change the European conditions, it became impossible. But it's also true that the European Union needs social democrats, because we want a certain kind of European Union. And the time has come to make it clear that the European Union is not only about a market or a monetary union. No, we want the European Union to become a full-fledged political entity. We want to have stronger European sovereignty, because we understood that if you want to address climate change, if you want to redirect the digital revolution, if you want to have better trade agreements, on all these, we need to have stronger and progressive European Union. And that's why the new phase is so important. So I believe this should be our major cause, is to use the European Union as a powerful leverage for our progressive agenda. That's it.
Thank you very much. If there is one very short question, I can still take it from the floor. Anybody else who would like to ask a question? If not, we will move forward. Oh, there was one. Please.
Hello, my name is Elisha Winkel from Luxembourg. My question is actually more to Maria Joao, and the question is basically just because she is already on the other side, right, as an elected representative. My question is more, in this room, you see many people who represent organizations. So they are the international secretary or the person who is responsible, the delegate for the bureau meetings. But you also have like activists present in this room. So like really the grassroots, those that make our organizations great and those that are really there to help lift the work. And my question to you is just, what can they do to really support S&D and make this election a great success for our political family? So what can they do if they are just an activist? I mean, I don't mean just an activist, right? The activists are very important and they are the backbone of all our organizations. But what can they do in their personal life to just make it as a success? Thank you.
Okay, this is a beautiful question to conclude our talk. Let me tell you the following. Of course, now for the next weeks, it's very important the way we work together to campaign and to win elections everywhere, to have the best outcome we can have. Because a lot will depend on the balance of power we can get for the next phase. But I would say this is not enough, because once we have our people in the new European institutions, we need to find a way to go on working together to come up with the best solutions to address people's needs. And this is missing, because right now, let me tell you, we PS family, we have a good basis to campaign. We have a good manifesto based on, I believe, good resolutions. A lot of people have participated in preparing this agenda for elections. But I should tell you that in parallel, we are also preparing an agenda to run the government of the European Union for the next phase. Because we Social Democrats, we have responsibilities in this direction. And I believe that we need to find a way to work all over. Whenever we are addressing all the challenges we talk about today, we need to make sure that we work together all over, not just for elections, but once we are already there, taking our responsibilities. And this is something we need to invent. That's why I'm saying we need to go beyond the traditional way for democratic representative institutions to work. We need to have a permanent interface coming up with new ideas, with new solutions, and which are inventing on the ground by all the stakeholders, by all the associations, by all the NGOs. So this is a completely different way for our democracy to operate. This is my answer to your question.
Very good. Thank you so much for all the questions. Thank you for very enlightening answers. I will give you a very short round of closing remarks. As a last thing for our audience, what do you want to tell us? Closing words.
Well, again, thank you. And closing remark, yes, it's the Congress of Young European Socialists. So first of all, we have to be proud that we managed to have this organized and we managed to be here to have very interesting and successful debates regarding a lot of important issues. And then at the end, we should not forget to have a bit of fun.
Yeah, so I'll just say what Anna says, do the revolution and dance with it, because otherwise it's not our revolution, right?
Okay, my last wish is to make Helsinki the starting point for a big, big, big movement for a progressive Europe. I'm sure that we count on yes to lead this new phase. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Thank you for our great panelists, and looking forward to the takeover for us that starts from Helsinki. Very good. Dear friends, we are now moving forward in the program. So we have a lot of important friends of YES, like we say, who would have loved to join us today, but unfortunately couldn't. So luckily, video messages have been invented, and therefore we will be now moving on for a video message from a Romanian Social Democratic member of the European Parliament, Emilian Pavel.
Dear comrades, dear friends, thank you for giving me the opportunity to share some thoughts with you on a subject that matters a lot to me and, of course, to many other people. Topics like creating opportunities for youth or our involvement in the decision-making process are and should be very high on our and on the European Union's agenda. To me, as a Social Democrat and member of the European Parliament, they have been among my top priorities in this legislature for the last 5 years. Of course, we don't know how the future will look like exactly, but by working today for what will be tomorrow, we are however able to have an idea. And how great and empowering it was to see young and very young people taking on the streets of Europe and not only, and coming to the European Parliament, invited by us, by our group, and talking about these things they and us care about and demanding actions. For this perspective, the future starts to look a little brighter, and that is precisely thanks to the young people getting more and more involved. In the last 5 years, many of my over 2,300 amendments and most of my over 20 reports have pushed for more resources and more quality being allocated to programs focused on youth, on empowering the young people, on giving them more and more opportunities, and on keeping them away from precarity and apathy. Us, the Socialists and the Social Democrats, have always been in the front lines of the fight for a better, more progressive, more diverse, more sustainable and more inclusive future. And we should stay there. Comrades, from Greece to Finland and from Portugal to Poland, we are part of something greater. We are progressive, young people who care about our communities and who care about our larger European or even larger human community. And whatever we do for our living, each at her or his place, we should aim to leave something good behind us. As little as it may be, we should stay involved and get others to be involved and to hope and to fight for something better. That better future is within our grasps, and we matter because the future is us. Thank you.
Very good. Thank you to Emilian, even though you might not hear me unless you're watching it from the stream. Now, it's time to allow a little bit more young people to take the stage. So we have this great concept that has been used in many of similar activities before, of having always representatives of the youth joining the debate. And moving forward, I introduce you Mai Jensen Christensen.
Thank you very much. I'm very delighted to be here. I am myself a former Together ambassador, and that's what all of this is about now for the next couple of minutes. And I'm also, apart from being former Together ambassador, I'm also an activist in Young European Socialists. And I'm just so happy that the S&D group keeps including young people in discussions like this. It's super important for our movement right now in this, in many ways difficult, but also very important time in history to have young people included in our movement. I often hear that youth is our future, like the youth is the future. And well, I know grown-ups, experienced people mean well when they tell that to me. But to be honest, I also have to say, well, we young people, we're not just the future. Like we're now, we are here. And to be honest, we are quite impatient. We want to change the world, and we cannot wait 10, 20, 50 years to do it. We want to change the world now. But speaking about our movement, I definitely agree that young people is the future. If our movement all across Europe fails to include and engage young people now, our movement is going to die. It's just a matter of time. And that is why this topic that we're discussing here right now is so important, because we need to include more young people in the decision processes, not just have young people as smiley faces on posters or having them there to fill some kind of quota. Like we as young people, we demand to be heard. Like we will be there, we will have a seat at the negotiation table. And that's also why I'm so happy that the S&D group invited young people to this debate, why they are so keen to always have young Together ambassadors to raise the young voices, because we need to be there at the negotiating table. Because young people, we're not just, well, sometimes when I see a politician who has a portfolio that includes the youth, that portfolio is always also about like culture and sports, maybe education. And yes, it's true, like those things take up a lot of our time for young people, it's true. But these are not the only things that we should be associated with. Like young people are not just interested in culture and sports and education. We are interested in affordable housing, in quality jobs. And this is not just for us or our friends. We are also interested in good child care, fair pensions, a fair retirement age, climate change. Our interests don't stop with our hobbies or what we do in our everyday life or what our interests are. Like our political ambition and engagement is more broad than that, because this is not just about me and my young friends. This is about making sure that everybody all over Europe, all over the world, has the possibility, the opportunity to shape their own future, no matter where they're born, who their parents are, what color their skin, what the religion they believe in, what kind of sexuality they have. Like, no matter who you are, you should be able to shape your own future. And that is what we're fighting for. And I think sometimes when we're talking about engaging more young people in our movement and in the political discussions, I understand that it can be annoying to have these very impatient young people at the table. But I have to say that sometimes we're also impatient because some of our mother parties seem, I don't know, satisfied, but at least very occupied with just protecting what we already achieved. And that is important. And what we already achieved is threatened by right-wing parties who want to turn back the clock. And of course, we have to protect what we already achieved. But if that is the only vision that we have, not wanting to make things worse, then I have to say that our progressive family will end up being the most conservative family that there is. I often joke with that with my own party, and that is not what we want. We are the progressive force, and we have to show that. And when we manage to have the progressive ideas, to say that these societies, they can get better, we can be proud of what we achieved already, but we can always push it further. And when we do that, that's when young people will engage in our movement, and we really, really need that. So that's also why I'm so super honored to get the opportunity to present to you two brand new Together ambassadors chosen among all the grassroots here at the Young European Socialists. And so please welcome to the stage Stefan Hofinger and Nikolina Hildur Sveindottir. Okay, so I think that all these speeches, all these experienced politicians maybe have made some food for thought for you. So I would like Stefan to start.
Thank you. So, hello, I'm Stefan from Socialist Youth Austria. And at the moment in Austria, I'm experiencing what is happening all over Europe, the strengthening of the far right. The Austrian government is a coalition of the conservatives and the right-wing parties. To give an example of the situation, our intelligence agency was raided by the Ministry of Internal Affairs to obtain documents about the right-wing extremists and their link to the Vice Chancellor's party last year. This is the situation in Austria right now. The far right is taking more and more ground, and things that years ago were unthinkable, now done without any public discussion or hesitation. But this is also due to the failure of social democracy to appeal to the workers in the last decades. We let go of the fight for the working class and were happy to just defend the status quo. But this is not enough. We need to set the agenda with new and revolutionary demands to fight for. Over the last 20 years, the far right managed to shift the discourse. It is our duty to shift it back to the left. And most importantly, we must not get trapped in legitimizing the racist agenda of the far right by collaborating with them on matters like the integration of refugees. No, we have to be brave again and fight for what we know is right and not compromise it, which we hope will get us maybe elected. Because people fight for principles and not compromises. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And now to Nikolina, you are from Iceland, so you also have a view on the European cooperation.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. So Iceland is not a member of the European Union for now. It's been a constant policy within the Social Democratic Alliance of Iceland and in turn our youth organization, of which I'm president, UJ Iceland. But we have to be really careful and strategic about how we bring our policy to the people of Iceland, because even though most people, when asked if they are pro-EU, they are like in the polls. But we do have these forces in Iceland, as we do in most countries in Europe, that are very, very anti-EU. And what has to be brought into this discussion is that the feeling of independence, which is very important to Icelanders. We only got our independence 75 years ago this year. So, and that's the sort of tool that the anti-EU parties and even just public of Iceland have been using. Currently, in the Icelandic parliament, there are only two parties that are actively pro-EU, and fortunately, they are also two of the parties that are polling strongest with the young people of Iceland. So we are very hopeful. What we think in UJ Iceland is that young people need to see that their actions and opinions matter. If you take, for example, the Parliament of Iceland, we had the last election in October of 2017. Before that, the percentage of women to men was 47.6%, so really, really close. After the election of 2017, it went down to 38%. And in that, the Social Democratic Alliance is not innocent at all. We have four male MPs and three female MPs, and that's because of the six like regions in Iceland, we put forth four men in the first place and two women in the first place. When it comes to age in the parliament, the median age in the Icelandic parliament is currently 50. In the Social Democratic Alliance, our youngest MP is 37 years old. And that's not because of a lack of young, progressive, smart, intelligent, strong women, believe me. Case in point. What I feel is that the future is bright because young people are aware of the current state our world is in right now. And like many of the speakers before me have said, the time to act is now. Our climate is in decline and it's humanity's fault. And look who's reacting to it. Look who's striking every Friday at noon for the climate. We have a situation in Iceland where some of the schools have started offering their students pizza instead of going out striking. And what message does that send to them? The institutions that are supposed to prepare our youth are cajoling them into giving up their core values for pizza. We tell kids that actions speak louder than words. What we have to realize is that what's needed to emphasize the importance of having a seat at the table and a role in the decision-making progress is to listen to young people, to make them feel like their voices are being heard and that their opinions matter, empowering them to keep up the good fight. Because young people are the ones who realize what has to be done and have the tools to do it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Stefan and Nicolina. And thank you so much to the S&D group for making this possible. And we really hope that you will keep engaging young people as Together ambassadors. You know, we are here. We are ready to take responsibility. We are ready to engage in the decision-making processes. So we really look forward to continuing the cooperation. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, my Nicolina and Stefan. Very great.
Now it's time to conclude. And for the conclusions, I give you the president of Young European Socialists, João Albuquerque.
Okay, hello everyone. A bit sad to see such an empty room, but very thankful to the S&D group and to all our partners for the effort that they have put into organizing this and to include us once more in this event. It's extremely important for us, and I believe that we have shown that we have the people in our organizations that are able to mobilize young people in order to spread the message and to actually make the difference with the policies that we want to implement. With the previous speakers, we have heard several topics being addressed, and I think that it's a very good time to try to make a summary of what was said here and at what we have been repeating and demanding for as European youth. The first thing is protecting identities. Many times we have seen that the right has mobilized against us, accusing us of having a gender ideology, some sort of cultural Marxism, as this is being said. I think Camilla really much summarized the importance of identity politics in the way that not defending human rights and not defending the right for personal identity of these people means that we are sending a message to these people that they should be invisible, that they should not exist, that they should not be in the public sphere, that they should not have the right to take ownership of politics. What we are saying as young socialists, and with the help of Rainbow Rose, I think we have achieved this in many occasions, is that regardless of your identity, you have a voice, and regardless of your identity, you have the right to take ownership of your future. And this means that you can not only be an activist, but you can also be a representative of other activists and of the people around you. And I think Camilla really embodies these values, and I think that Rainbow Rose has made a terrific job in doing this. We had the chance, for example, in Romania, when there was a controversy, and we did this discussion also with our Romanian comrades, to actually influence and lobby the Romanian comrades in order to have a different approach and a different view on a law to which we didn't offer our full support. And I think this was a very good example of how we can cooperate between YES and Rainbow Rose. The other big topic was regarding environment and sustainability. Every time I've had a chance of talking about this, people got a little bit tired of me repeating this, but I think that it's never enough to say this and to stress this enough. We don't have a planet B, we don't have other option, so we really need to subordinate all policies that we are doing in terms of economic rights, social rights, everything, to the future of the environment and to sustainability. Otherwise, we will fail to build a house from the ground because we would not have the ground to build that house for. It was also brought here by Anna, the importance of international solidarity and international cooperation. For many years, and we have to acknowledge, I think Andrea has brought this repeatedly when talking about feminism, that we have to acknowledge the society in which we live in and the patriarchal society that we live in. We also have to acknowledge that the international cooperation that we need to do also needs to acknowledge the past that Europe has in regard to the relations with other continents. And we need to make sure that this relation respects the responsibility, the historic responsibility that Europe has towards other continents, Africa especially, but also in other places in Asia. And we need to change the view under which Europe cooperates with other continents. I think the initiative of the S&D, for example, regarding the Africa Week that is made every year and that has shifted, I think we had several people here that participated in this Africa Week. Kasper was actually very active on this, shifting the paradigm on which we relate ourselves with Africa, for example, saying that the cooperation needs to be with Africa and not from Europe to Africa. The other thing is that we cannot make this change having a deeper effect and impact on the middle class and on the most unprotected classes of our society. This means that, for example, regarding energetic transition, we need to make sure that we protect the most vulnerable people, and that we need to make sure that this doesn't affect the people on their ordinary lives, so that we can achieve our climate goals. We need to, as Camilla also stressed out very well, that we need to put the burden of changing behaviors, especially in a collective way, on those that pollute the most and contribute more to the production of this pollution and to these emissions, which are the corporate sector. And finally, Maria João said something that for me it's also very important. We need to reinvent representative democracy. And I think that the sign that we tried to give here with this Congress was that young people are ready to take over regarding what are the future politics that we want to implement. And this doesn't happen not only here inside of this room, but everywhere in Europe. The things that we have been watching recently regarding climate and tackling climate, it has been something that we as young European socialists have been repeating over and over the years. You can see it throughout the development of our position paper that we have been insisting on this necessity. And it's very refreshing that people are gaining more and more awareness of the necessity, the real necessity of bringing this climate change into effectiveness. And for this to then become policy, we need to restructure also the way that we participate in our democracies and how we can engage these people into become real actors of change in terms of political decision. And I think that the ideas that Maria João brought here, and I want to congratulate also the work that FEPS has done, for example, with the Millennial Project as a research, shows that young people are actually motivated to participate in politics, and the young people really want to be part of this change. They are just disconnected with the way that the system works and the fact that it doesn't work in favor of them. So to conclude, again, to thank the S&D group for all the effort that was made here, for all the speakers that have actually joined us, and to share the idea that was also made by our Finnish comrades, by Mia Petra and by Anton, to wish you not only a very successful election in the upcoming 2 weeks, but also to share this idea that the work that you have done and that Anton shared with us so well regarding having an extensive work to come up with policies and not just trying to simplify what's actually very complex. To telling people that what we are proposing is difficult to implement because it requires a lot of community and collective effort, but it works in favor of our communities rather than increasing the inequalities that the current model perpetuates. So I really hope that this change that we want to see in Finland for the next 2 years actually is a lead for the change that we want to see in other countries. We were very happy when Stefan Löfven managed to have and to form the government in Sweden and to maintain social democratic power in Sweden, because it really contributes for a change in the country after so many years of liberal policies. We want that to happen also in Finland and to other countries in Europe. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, João. And as it is, now we are finished with all of our speeches for today. I would now like to give a few technical notes for all of you for the next steps, what's going to happen further tonight. But first, I want to thank everybody who followed us online. I'm very sorry that you will not be able to join these next steps that I'm now going to explain to you. So, tonight, we still have two very important, actually three very important moments in front of us. Next, at 7 p.m., we have received the great honor of getting an invitation for the Helsinki City Hall. We are going to be hosted for an evening reception by the deputy mayor responsible for youth, culture, and sports of Helsinki, Nazima Razmiar. She is a very progressive, social democratic young politician and also a former member of the Social Democratic Youth here in Finland. In the last European elections, we voted for her to be elected in the European Parliament. Now we're going to visit her at the City Hall where she is the deputy mayor. On our way there, we have
an important task to do. Before we leave, I would like all of you to gather to the lobby where we will give you balloons. And you are expected to carry the balloons until the city hall, because we're going to turn this into a little European march, so to say. So please hold your balloons tight and hand them out for our volunteers before entering the city hall, because I'm pretty sure that the city hall doesn't want 200 balloons into their main reception room. So please, after we are finished here, I'm also going to ask you to assemble for a group picture next, so don't run away yet. Please get your stuff. Take your jackets, take your bags, take your computers, take your papers, take everything, because we're not coming back to this room today. So please collect all of your stuff. Take your coats from the cloakroom if needed, and get a balloon from one of our volunteers. And when we say it, we all leave together. So I ask you to wait for our departure announcement at the downstairs lobby. But first, please come here to the stage, all of us, for a group photo. So, could I have everybody, some people standing on the stage, some people in front, we will make a nice thing.